It's about that time again. Let's get into the latest episode of The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, and I have a lot to say. So welcome back to the Kempire Daily YouTube channel. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and let me know where you're watching from and how you'd rate the latest episode of The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. So as you know, for months now, people have been waiting to see what this Aspen trip was all about. And now that it's finally here, it's interesting. I have to say I was engaged with this episode, but I know what everyone is thinking. Kempire, what do you think about this whole Erika Jane and the earring situation? As you know, we've been covering all of the Tom Girardi and Erika Jane situation since it broke a couple of years ago at this point. And we've said this countless times. During last season, I tried to keep an open mind about the Erika involvement situation. Look, we understand that Erika Jane did not herself steal money from victims that we know of. All of the clues have fallen back on Girardi Keys. And as I've said countless times, there's no way that Tom Girardi could get away for years, decades, for stealing from victims alone. He wasn't the only one involved. There were partners involved. There were accountants involved. There were banks involved. There were plenty of people guarding and safeguarding this whole situation for it to keep going on. Do I think that Erika knew something? That's debatable. At this point, based off of Erika's behavior on The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, it makes us believe that she did know something. Or she was just so caught up in living the lifestyle and benefiting from this lifestyle that she doesn't care. And I think that has been the biggest issue for a lot of people that may have liked Erika before, but now have seen this other very materialistic, very cold and callous and just compassionless person. We will get back into that, but let's just start from the top. So this episode is called The Girl with the Diamond Earrings because it's all about those diamond earrings that we've been covering and talking about that Tom Girardi reportedly, I don't even know if I even have to say reportedly because there are receipts that he bought these earrings that are now worth over $1 million. I believe Erika said in this episode that these earrings at one point were worth $3 million. So as we know, based off of multiple, I think the Bravo docket had listed, this was determined that he bought these earrings with victims' settlement money. All right. So at the top of this episode, Kyle is complaining. Look, last season when we saw Kyle and Kathy together, it was enjoyable to see these sisters go back and forth. It gets dark this season, as you know, because we saw the preview of this. Kathy Hilton apparently says something about Kyle that breaks her heart. We'll get there. But Kyle at the top of this episode is talking about Kathy's slippers that she wore to Aspen that are hotel slippers. Look, Kathy Hilton is quirky. She's weird. She is rich to a point where she doesn't care. She's not trying to impress anybody. It's those people that you see all the time on these shows trying to impress the world with their riches that usually are not as rich as they seem. They're probably rich, but they're not as rich as they seem. Kathy Hilton is so rich, she doesn't care. And she's been so rich for this long, has been around real rich people for this long. She doesn't care that the cameras are on her. However, she does care to promote her tequila. Whatever, we'll get to the tequila in a second. All right, so Kyle's complaining to the other ladies about, did you see what Kathy wore here? I think Kyle is just embarrassed by Kathy sometimes, especially because Kyle wants to make the world and her friends believe that, you know, we are, you know, she's more materialistic. You know, anytime someone has a certain bag or a certain thing, she is very materialistic. Nothing wrong with it, but you could tell the difference between Kyle and her lifestyle and Kathy and her mentality and her lifestyle. Anyways, unimportant. So Kyle, Lisa, Rena, and Erika are just talking about what happened the night before. As you know, last week's episode, Diana and Sutton went through whatever they went through. I'm still very confused why that even turned into what it turned to. Again, I feel like Madam Diana Jenkins, New Money Jenkins, is sidebar. I saw that Dana Wilkie deleted those podcast episodes. Look, I'm not doing separate videos talking about some of this stuff. When we recap Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, it's a perfect time to get into what has been going on when it comes to these stories. Speaking of which, Diana Jenkins also made a $100,000 donation to the Lion Air victims, which confused a lot of people. But I'm sure those people that were confused, especially because she has such a close relationship now with Erika, why she would make a donation to this, to the Lion Air victims. Because according to Erika in this episode, there are no victims. Allegedly, there are no victims. Or are they really victims? Erika is really playing with people's minds and confronting people like Crystal or the other ladies, especially these ladies that won't read a short article about this stuff. You and I have seen all the multiple reports and the evidence, and we've seen legal minds weigh in on what has been going on. So when she says, cite your sources, cite them. We'll get back to that. Let me focus. I just, when these things pop in my mind, I want to talk about them. But back to this. So Diana made a $100,000 donation. She created the Sinella Foundation. Someone I heard said that this foundation was recently created and she made the donation. The interesting thing to me is the timeliness of this, because she knew that this episode was airing. So now the news comes out that she's making this donation. Great, all well and good. The Pretty Mess commented on her Instagram post about this, all hearts. I thought there were no victims, Erika. Okay, I know she can explain that away. Well, there are victims, but is it true that Tom or the Girardi Keys did take their settlement money? I know what she's going to say. I know what all of you Erika fans are going to say in regards to it. Okay, so she makes this donation. My thing is, if this was a real donation, Diana, why make it now in time for the cameras? Some will argue, well, she couldn't technically make the donation earlier because of this has to play out on the show. All right. I think, great, make a donation. She even says later in the episode about Garcelle and everyone bringing up these earrings. Well, if there's such an issue, just make a donation. I've seen that argument. No, yes, it would be fantastic for all of us to gather our money together and make donations to these victims of Tom Girardi. Victims that were already victims, then made victims again by Tom Girardi and Girardi Keys. Fantastic. However, very much like what Erika is saying, no, all of this needs to play out. Before we start donating, first of all, we have to have a place that we trust to make a donation. However, we need to let this play out, like Erika says, to figure out all the facts. What exactly did Tom Girardi do? How much money did Tom actually take? How much assets can we actually get from Tom Girardi? Before we start to figure out how much is still needs to be paid that we can't pay because Tom Girardi was spending this money on Erika Jane, her failing music career, and his side pieces. Even his side piece, the woman judge, gave back all of the money and the things that Tom Girardi had bought for her. We'll get back to that. So the ladies are talking about what happened the night before with Diana and Sutton, whatever. Diana was looking for a moment and then turned it into a woe is me and left. So they talk about, Kyle talks to Erika and Lisa, you know, Sutton is different one-on-one, but this, it feels like a mean girl mentality. And when I saw the original clip of this scene, I said, of all people to talk about mean girls, Kyle and Lisa Rinna and Erika. Look, I agree. The reason why Sutton unfollowed Erika seemed petty. First of all, I was surprised that Sutton was even following Erika after last season. But the reason why Sutton unfollowed, the reason that she gave for unfollowing Erika, I can say that was petty. She was whatever. She's not innocent there. I understood why Garcelle unfollowed Erika. But in the age of muting people, you could do that too, because Garcelle knows people are watching who she's following, who unfollowing things. But Garcelle does that. But they say, you know, one-on-one, Sutton's fantastic. Look, Sutton's not innocent. Sutton is quirky. She's weird. She does say things that you make go like, okay. But I have to say, they've been targeting Sutton every single episode. We're on episode 17, and they were still targeting Sutton. At one point, Lisa Rinna says, well, you know, with pain, she's acting, you know, Diana's acting out in rage because she's in pain. Maybe so, but she wasn't in pain right before calling Sutton a see you next Tuesday and then laughing with Erika about it. Then all of a sudden, you made fun of my miscarriage. Mind you, Sutton has apologized to Diana multiple times about that. Dorit. So we've talked countless times about Dorit and her storyline this season. As you know, Dorit during the season had a home invasion and she conveniently decides, I'm not going to stay with the rest of the group. Because remember, there was two separate homes, those staying with Kyle, but she wasn't going to stay with Kyle. She was going to stay with Garcelle, Sutton, and Crystal. Oh, she decides because Diana has a hotel that she's staying at, I feel more secure there. Kyle makes a joke and says, well, I think she also likes a really nice hotel. I think it could be that, but I also think it's just Dorit not wanting to hang out or befriend the other ladies. A lot of you have said the reason why Dorito has become so unlikable on the show is because she's sort of fallen in line with the Fox Force flunkies. And I think she didn't want to be with the other ladies or bond with the other ladies. And she wanted to stay at a nice hotel. Dorito is so fake. But anyway, I'll get to Dorito in a second. Sidebar, did you notice later in the episode when they were talking about Doritos, when Lisa Rinna brings up Doritos and the editors pan in on Dorit? It was not lost on me. Did you not notice that? I kikied the second time watching it again. Just saying. So we have that. So the groups separate for their activities on this day. We have the group that's going to go skiing, and then we have the group that's going snowmobiling. There we go. And Erika, who's not getting along with Sutton, who's not getting along with Garcelle, goes with the snowmobiling. She wasn't going to go skiing. But Kyle, Crystal, Lisa Rinna, and... oh, Mauricio. Some of you are like, why is Mauricio there? He said, this is the perfect time to go skiing. His whole point in going on this girls' trip was to go skiing. All right? So that group goes and they go skiing. I have to say, oh, Diana. Okay, and look, I don't want to be ignorant. This is why I'm going to ask the question. We've heard that Diana Jenkins talk about growing up very poor, you know, from where she's from. But I found it to be interesting. And look, skiing could be a way that people grow up. You know, here in the States, if you're going skiing, you usually have a little something. You usually have a little something. Unless you grow up in like a ski town. I thought, and I'm sure some of you thought, I thought Diana grew up poor. Why was she, her father buying her skis and like go skiing? That to me, maybe where she's from, skiing is not a certain stature. But in my brain, I'm thinking, if you're going skiing as a kid, were you that poor? Asking for all of us. So Diana is a good skier. It was kind of cool to see all of them skiing. Dorito says, I haven't skied in 20 years. Dorito probably skied once and was like, oh, you know. I think Dorito just likes to put on like she is that person. She is from that lifestyle. There's nothing real about Dorito. I think she may have skied once in her life. And she's like, I don't, you know, she was the worst skier. I like seeing Crystal just be a boss and just being great at everything. I like seeing that with Crystal, her going down the slope. She's like, she's competitive. Everyone was skiing. It looked fun. I've never been skiing. Would I do it? I don't know. I don't think I'm going to do it. It's very dangerous too. God forbid you hit your head. Oh my, no, never mind. I've moved on. Isn't that how Sonny Bono died? Look, just saying. No skiing for me. But it was nice to see everyone skiing and doing well. All right? And again, I was trying to be open to Diana Jenkins. Before everything that's played out on social media with Diana Jenkins, I really have tried. But every time, and a lot of you have said this in the comments and when you've called in, it feels like something is off with Diana. Like our intuitive nature is looking at Diana and just feeling like, girl, something's not right with you. Like I don't want to even call her what we usually call her. I want to say Diana cringeworthy Jenkins, because every scene with her, it feels forced, it feels fake, it feels inauthentic. That's just the way that I feel. So there were moments when they were picking her up and she's talking about, I'm just like, like when we talk about new money, and there are a bunch of people that are considered new money, it's like she just reeks of new money. Like, you just inauthentic, fake. But I kind of get that feeling. Shout out to people in California. And that's part of the reason why I can never live in California, because I feel like it's people like her that are at these parties and at these events. I'm just like, I think I would be bored and just turned off. Anyways, moving along. So we have the other group where we have Sutton, Erika, Cherie. Cherie, I have to say, you know, she's not a bad friend of, and I know a lot of people have been calling her a pick me, and you don't like Cherie because she's hanging out with the Foxworth flunkies. I don't mind her. You know, I like her real friendship with Garcelle. I like every once in a while she'll chime in and make us laugh. I don't mind her. You know, at least she offers something, unlike some of our other friend ofs in other cities. So, the ladies go snowmobiling with Erika. It is awkward in the car, but they sort of warm up to each other. They do talk about what happened the night before between Sutton and Diana, and Erika tries to explain it. And at one point, Sutton's like, I like you. She likes to say that about Erika and Lisa Renner. We're all like, girl, I don't know why you like them. I don't know if Sutton, part of Sutton, is standing on her own because, you know, her friendship with Garcelle and what the fans have been saying to Sutton. But I also think Sutton does want to be a part of the Fox Force flunkies on some level. And that could be just the way that she grew up, wanting to be a part of the cool girl group. I don't know. But every time she says, oh, I like you. I really do like you. And I'm like, girl, why? There's nothing very likable about Erika Jane. Based on what we've seen, there's just like nothing likable. But I'm not going to lie, and I've said this before, I do like seeing them get along. I'm not one of those people that needs to see these women pulling their hair out and cursing at each other every single episode. I enjoy when they have a good time together and they're quirky and they're fun. I do like that. And I did like the fact that this group that normally wouldn't get along, especially with Erika and Garcelle and Erika and Sutton, were getting along and having a good time. And they were talking about what happened the night before. Erika was trying to explain Diana's side and saying, you know, this is what's happening. So they have that, and they have a good time with each other. So Garcelle before, first of all, Garcelle on the snowmobile, Garcelle's like, I cannot with the snowmobile. I don't understand why Garcelle, you're a fraidy cat. Are you a fraidy cat? I don't know if I would do it, but she was just like, go very slow. Poor Sutton. At one point, Sutton, you know, during the instructions for the snowmobiling, she's over speaking to the animals. She's like, I like to speak to animals. The animals really give me calm and peace. I'm like, okay, Sutton. All right, so Sutton is quirky. She's quirky. She's weird, but I don't mind that. I like that for us. All right. So we move on from that. Garcelle and Crystal, before meeting up with the rest of the group for dinner, talk about these earrings again. As you know, last week they FaceTimed with each other, and Garcelle talked about this on The Real. The Real was still on at the time of this. And she's like, you know, I talked about it on the show. But as you know, once it became known about these $750,000, now $1 million worth earrings, it was everywhere on the news. So they're in Aspen and it is making the rounds on social media. So Crystal and Garcelle talk about it before they go to dinner. And they say, you know, it's blowing up. And if it was me, I would just give the earrings. So there was a point where I was a little confused in regards to what they were talking about. Would you just give up the earrings if you didn't know whether or not they were bought with victims' money? Look, a lot of what Erika Jane has in her closet or in her possession may or may not have been bought with victim money. We don't know. And I've said this before. I understand that Erika Jane cannot just start giving everything away. You know what I mean? However, one thing that we have to keep in mind in the timeline of this, even when they were filming this, it was being said that Erika Jane's earrings were bought with victim money. There were receipts about this. And that's what the headlines were saying. I'm glad that they highlighted the headlines, because part of me was like, okay, what are they just talking? They should just give the earrings. I can understand why Erika would not be just giving all her personal belongings to the bankruptcy. I could get that, because you don't know. Was this bought with legitimate money? Was this bought with legitimate money? Was this bought with victim money? Look, but what we've said before, it's not about Erika Jayne giving up everything. It's about Erika Jayne not trying to change the narrative of what her husband did. And at the end of this episode, we see her try to downplay if anyone's actually a victim. And look, Crystal, caught in the moment, probably can't even think of all of the things that have been said on social media about what Tom Girardi did. At the time of this filming, it was already determined. Joey Ruiz Gomez, he already had a judgment against Tom for stealing his money. The Lion Air victims, same. And God only knows how many other victims. But the ones that stood out to me was the fact that, yes, these two victims of Tom, victims that were victims and then victimized by Tom Girardi, had judgments against them. Girardi Keats and Tom Girardi. So we knew, yes, you saying that, we don't know if their claims are true. We don't know who took their settlement money. No, we know with Joey Ruiz Gomez. We know with the Lion Air victims. It was your husband. And although you did not do it, very much like what Kyle says at the end of this episode, you gotta show some sympathy. But I tweeted this before. Look, nope, she doesn't have to. Be who you are. Show me who you are. And Kyle, you, as someone that is actually friends with Erika, she's showing you who she is. She is a person who does not care about anyone but herself, including you, who's supposedly her friend. Just saying. But we'll get to that. So Garcelle and Crystal have this conversation about that. And they say, if it was me, I'd be giving up the earrings. The way that it's edited, it makes it seem as if they would just give up the earrings, even if they don't know if it was bought with victim. I mean, that means that everything that Erika has in her possession that was bought by Tom, she should be giving up. And I don't necessarily agree with that. However, what I do believe, these earrings specifically, there's receipts saying that this was bought with victims' money. Those earrings, at one point worth $3 million, would go a long way. Would go a long way. I mean, it's not going to scratch the surface, really, when it comes to the millions and millions of dollars that Tom Girardi has stolen from his clients. So they have that conversation, and then we have the group dinner. At the group dinner, again, we get these little quirky, silly moments with Kathy Hilton. Kathy Hilton is walking around Aspen looking like, who did it? Because she's just dressed down, barely any makeup. There was a scene back at Kyle's Aspen house where Kathy's sleeping in the bunk bedroom, and she's like, I don't have any room in the closets. She's like, what's your thing with hangers? She's like, I have hangers, but there's no room to fit any of my clothing. We have those cute little moments with them. Another cute moment with the group dinner is Kathy Hilton is, she didn't bring an actual purse. She brought like a shopping, I don't even know what it was. It wasn't anything special. It's probably a free thing that you get when you buy something from one of these stores. So Kyle is pointing those things out in regards to that. But she also brings up that, she has all of these expensive bags from some of the top designers from around the world. And she says it's in a storage at the Waldorf. And I'm like, wait, so it's just sitting in storage? Like, do you not have access to it? Of course, Erika Jayne, who is impressed by nothing but riches, she's materialistic, look, it is what it is. This is who she is. Show me who you are. And she's like, oh my God, can we go to it? Can we go? And then she starts bragging about, Erika Jayne starts bragging about all the things that she's has over the years. And Garcelle, understandably, is uncomfortable. She's like, this is literally being filmed. And it's going to be shown around the country. And the victims are watching this. And you're bragging about all of these designer bags and things that you have and blah, 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 blah. Garcelle's like, this does not look good. This does not look good. So they have that, Garcelle and Erika then start talking about this earrings And that's when we find out, I believe the earrings at one point were worth $3 million. So Tom bought them for $750,000. However, they have increased in worth. I believe now they're worth $1 point something million. So they kind of go back and forth. And Garcelle, forever the producer, and we appreciate it, because if we left it up to the Fox Force Funkies, we wouldn't be talking about what's going on social media when it comes to these earrings that were bought with client money. So Garcelle's just asking Erika about, like, these earrings. She's like, you know, do you not feel anything for the victims? And we will get back to this conversation. But Erika defends, like, you know, they have to go through the legal process. They have to go through the legal process. Okay. So they go back to, I believe this was the Garcelle and, you know, the other, this is not Kyle's Aspen home, but the other home where they're the agency rental that they're staying at. So they go back there. All the ladies are hanging out. Lisa Rinna is eating edibles. She shares an edible with Cherie. Cherie's like, it tastes like weed. I've never had an edible. I've never had that. So I was just like, oh, if it just tastes like weed, then I guess you just want it for the high. And like, they don't add a little sugar to make it interesting and tasty. I guess maybe that particular brand does, because I've heard people say, no, there are certain ones that if you taste them. Why are we having a conversation about edible? Anyways, we'll move on. So Lisa Rinna is high. She's trying to get Cherie high. Whatever. So they do that. But at one point, Kathy Hilton comes out, because Kathy Hilton has her tequila. So she's promoting it. Apparently, a month ago, at, I believe at Diana's party, she's promoting this tequila and talking about how Nikki's investing in da-da-da-da. And they're all like, God, Kathy, this tequila, blah, 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 who cares? But Sutton's like, I don't even drink tequila. I drink vodka, whatever. I'm like, okay. But it's important to pay attention to this scene, because next week it causes issues with Kathy and the rest of the group, specifically her sister. Makes us believe, then, is this what the drama is about? Maybe, maybe. So they have, Kathy promotes her tequila. Diana says that everyone can help the victim. So this leads to Garcelle, Dorito, Sutton. Oh, no, Sutton wasn't there. It was Diana and Crystal. They were having a conversation about the earrings. And then Garcelle called Erika over, because she's like, I don't want you to feel like we're talking behind your back. And this is what leads to a confrontation between Erika and Crystal. Because Chris is like, if it was me, I would just give the earrings back. I would just give the earrings back. And that's when Erika goes off. Because Erika knows who to get nasty with like this. Because you teach people how to treat you. You've never seen Erika speak the way that she speaks to a Sutton or a Crystal to Garcelle. She's never gotten that hateful and nasty to Garcelle. Because she knows who to do that with. And she literally does that with Crystal, saying that you're just concerned with public opinion. I want the law to play out. The law will help these people, not public opinion, me just giving back the earrings. That's all well and good. That's all well and good. What I wish someone would have said in that moment when she says, cite your, she didn't say cite your sources, that's what we say. But she was like, cite your information, let us know, where are your facts? Where are your facts? And Crystal's just like, but there are facts. Like I've said before, there are plenty of facts. But of course, Crystal in the moment's not going to be able to cite all the facts of, well, there's this victim, there's that victim. She's not covering these stories like we're covering these stories. And if it was a lawyer that has been covering these stories, I'm sure an Emily D. Baker would have listed, like, well, there's this. This one, that one. If a real attorney, and we've said this before during the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills season 11 reunion, it would have been fantastic, instead of Andy Cohen hosting this situation, is having a real lawyer. You know what I mean? Or have a lawyer on hand to be like, well, what about this? What about that? You know what I mean? So that would have been, can you imagine if Erika was on Roni with an Ebony K. Williams? Because Ebony could be like, well, what about this, Erika? That's why it would have been really cool to kind of see her in the mix with them. But of course, she doesn't live in Beverly Hills. So this conversation between Erika and the ladies goes left. At one point, she's yelling at Crystal. Another point, she's yelling at Dorit, because Dorit's like, well, are you saying that there are no victims? And that's a narrative that she's been saying countless times. And that's why when people are Erika fans, I'm like, how can you defend this woman when she literally, when there are victims that have judgments against Tom Girardi? No one is saying that Erika is the one who did it, but Erika seems to be protecting the man that did it countless times. But here we are. So it goes left. She starts yelling at Crystal. She even gets nasty with Dorito. And then Kyle is across the room and it's just like, she can't say that. She can't say that. She needs to show some sympathy to the victims. She needs to show some sympathy to the victims. And look, part of me feels like, is Kyle just saying that? Or, you know, does she really feel that? Or is she saying that because she knows how fervent fans and people that have been hearing and following the story feel about this? And I think that's what Erika is frustrated with. She's like, you're just concerned with public opinion and not the facts. No, people have hearts. But like I said, no, Erika, show me who you really are. Show me who you really are. At one point, Erika says, I don't give an F about anyone else but me. And I said, when we saw that in the trailer, I like to see the full situation. Again, we're watching an edited scene, but literally nothing prefaces this. She just says, I don't care about anyone but me. Point blank period. She doesn't care about these fans. She doesn't care about these victims. She doesn't care about anyone but her and maintaining the lifestyle that she has been, that she has attained through her husband, who has been stealing from his clients. She's okay with it. She's okay with it. Okay, Erika, we know who you are. When people show you who they are the first time, believe them. Believe them. But Kyle goes off on Erika. He's like, you can't say that. Well, there was that little moment when Kyle curses and Kathy's like, don't curse Kyle. And she's like, Kyle's like, what? She's like, don't. I mean, random, but I'm glad they kept it in. But Kyle is saying what a lot of people are saying. You can't say these things. But I'm like, Kyle, no, let her say it. That's her truth. I think the problem here, this is also Kyle thinking about, I can't be friends with someone that is saying these things. She's exactly proving what Sutton said. Sutton's like, yeah, I'm concerned about my reputation because I deal with charities. I deal with people that Tom may have victimized or are in similar situations. How am I friends with a woman that shows no sympathy or empathy for these people? I can't be friends with a person like that because that's a true testament to her character. That's a true testament to her character. What does that say about me that I'm friends with this person? But Sutton, that also makes me look at you crazy. Like, how can you say, I really like you? No, I don't like you. Because just because you're nice to me doesn't really show me who you really are. What shows me who you really are is how you treat other people. That's one of the things that I use. If I'm dating someone, it's a real important thing for me when we're out and about is how you treat other people. You know, people in service, people that are just coming in, you know, like, oh, sorry, excuse me. If you're just like, like, to me, that shows me who you really are, because it will only take a certain amount. Because look, let's be honest, when you meet someone for the first time, friendship, dating, whatever, their representative shows up. Erika, for a very long time, her representative has showed up on the show. Now we're starting to see who Erika Jane really is. And who Erika Jane really is a selfish, materialistic person who cares about no one, not even Tom Girardi. She cares more about Tom Girardi, who's been stealing it from victims, than she does about any of these women, than any of her fans, and any of these victims. She doesn't. She doesn't. And she made it very clear. Lisa Rinna's like, oh God, we got to get her out of here, because if she says one more thing, I also cannot be friends with her, because look what she's saying. Girl, we got to get you out of here. We got to get you out of here. Yeah, get her out of here. Get her off of our screens. But I've said this before. When Erika Jane first came on the show, I was like, okay, maybe. We need someone that's going to be real and shake it up with these fake ladies. But she's been a big womp, womp, womp for a long time. And now at this point, it's like, why do we want to watch Erika Jane? Why? She's not interesting. She's not funny. She's not entertaining. What has she brought besides her legal drama on this show? Guys, I want to know your thoughts on this episode. What stood out to you the most? What did I not mention that you wanted to talk about? We can talk about it in the comment section. Don't forget to let me know where you're watching from. Don't forget to let me know how you would rate this episode. I probably would rate this episode, because it was interesting to watch, probably an 8. I thought this was a solid episode. You know, we had some funny moments, and then we had some serious moments, and then we had, you know, mixing up the group. It was interesting. But I am also ready for the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills reunion. Andy has already posted, let me know your questions. I want to see what this reunion is going to play out, because there's so much to cover. So much has happened off of the show that you know they're going to bring up for this reunion. This reunion is going to definitely be at least 3 parts. I could see it being 4 parts, because there's a lot to unpack. Some people are still speculating that Diana Jenkins is not going to come to the reunion. I believe that she will, but I also don't believe that she will be returning for another season. Sidebar, She by Sheree, girl, the website's down now again. A lot of you have been criticizing her for the prices of everything, understandably so. I love hearing the comments. Let's continue this conversation below in regards to the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. Our Real Housewives of Dubai recap will be coming shortly, so stay tuned for that. As you know, with these recaps, I love to watch the shows multiple times, so I pick up on certain things. So I will be doing a Real Housewives of Dubai later, so stay tuned for that. If you're not subscribed, subscribe, turn on your notifications, and don't forget to continue this conversation below. Thank you guys for being here.